Over these 4 days, we shall expect heaven to come down. Somebody shall have an encounter. Very unusual encounter with heaven. Your life shall rise up. Your life shall increase. There shall be a revival. Father, I give glory to you tonight for opening this program. At the end of the program, let the experience of revival continue. Bless everyone here tonight. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you take your seat, kindly turn your Bible to Psalm 6:3. Turn your Bible to Psalm 63. If you are there, shout to me and say, I am there. I read verses 1 and 2 for the beginning. And verse 1 begins by saying, O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. If you have the King James Version as I do, let's read verse 2 together. Read it very sound and loud. Read it louder than your neighbor. Come on, let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. To see thy power and thy glory, as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. In this sanctuary, over these 4 days, 2 things will characterize this meeting. The glory, the power. Hit your neighbor and say, neighbor, the glory of God shall fill this temple. Say to your neighbor, say, neighbor, the power of God shall be experienced in this place. To lay a foundation, it would be good I try to say what glory, because you are talking about the glorious church. I try to say what the glory of God is. Truly I can say all about the glory of God, but let's just try something. You talk about the glory of God, you are talking about his honor. You are talking about his dignity. You are talking about his splendor. You are talking about something that is splendid. You are talking about something beautiful. You are talking about something glamorous. But let me round it up all. You are talking about something that is powerful. Glory is a combination of honor, dignity, splendor, power put together. Can I hear someone say amen? In those characteristics of God that talk about splendor and talk about beauty and talk about might and greatness, glory is the highest expression. And that he said, I long for you. And I long to see your glory. That means that heaven wants that men and women who saw him should experience his glory, should see his glory. And that is why I want to stir somebody up here in this meeting to expect an encounter with the glory of God. When you encounter God's glory, there comes dramatic changes. When you encounter God's glory, controversies are settled. When you encounter God's glory, your life is transformed. When you encounter God's glory, your life is lifted. Your life is blessed. Your life is settled. For some time, the enemy has tried to toss your life up and down. For some time, the evil one has tried to throw spanners into your destiny. But I come here with the good news. I come to announce, over this weekend, your destiny shall find a settlement. Over this weekend, your life shall find an establishment. Over this weekend, your family shall find a stability. Hit your neighbor with your elbow and say, neighbor, stability, establishment, settlement. He said, I come to the temple to experience and to see your power and to see your glory. And then let me try to say something about the church. Someone said the church.
I know.
Somebody said the church.
Yeah.
Primarily, every single man and woman that believes in Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior is already the church. But we have a venerable here to be our chaplain. So maybe I want to sound a little bit theological. Jesus said, I will build my church. That's Matthew chapter 16. And so you see, the Bible is written, Old Testament written in Hebrew, New Testament written in Greek. So the Greek word from that Matthew chapter 16 is ecclesia. Ecclesia. So when the Greek talk about ecclesia, it's talking about the call outwards. We were all sinners, born in sin, from whatever tradition, from whatever background, from whatever race, from whatever tribe, from whatever attainment. We were born sinners. But by the gospel of Jesus Christ, which, by the way, it's a glorious gospel. By the gospel of Jesus, we heard the gospel. We were called by the gospel. We responded to the gospel. We came out. And as we received Jesus, we got hooked up with him. We got connected to him. And so because we are called out by the gospel, we have become people who are called out. We are the church. For the longest time, I've never been in a church auditorium of this size. Congratulations. Very sophisticated. I was trying to count the number of fans on one line. Very sophisticated. I like this choir. I like their equipment. I like this musical band. I like your setup. This is sophistication. Let's give Jesus a mighty hand.
But can I help you?
This is not the church. You are the church.
So you ask me, Pastor, what is this? Church building. Church auditorium. You own this auditorium.
for your conveniences.
That when the rain is falling, you can still worship.
When the sun is hitting, you can have a place. A protection against the rain and the sun. It's for your convenience and for your comfort. That's why you have the fans.
You say, where does God dwell? God dwells in you.
Where will he put his glory?
In you.
By the time that glory is oozing out of me, is oozing out of you, is oozing out of you, man, is oozing out of you, chairman, is oozing out of every one of us, then we will say, we have a glorious church.
Can I hear someone say, hallelujah?
And for your information, Jesus in you is the hope of glory. So the very day you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, glory of God came into you. Glory of God has been abiding in you. Glory of God has been dwelling in you. Yeah, there can be several visitations of the glory of God. But basically, the believer has received the glory of God by receiving Jesus, because Jesus is the embodiment of the glory of God. Does it make any sense to somebody?
You said, then, Pastor, why are you preaching to us over this weekend?
I am preaching to you so that you will allow the glory of God to manifest through your life. And that's my second point now. Someone said manifestation.
Oh, no, you're not talking to me. Someone said manifestation.
Shout louder one more time. Manifestation. Yeah. Manifestation. Manifestation. So let's go to Isaiah chapter 60. Anybody amongst us can read Isaiah 60, verses 1. And two. Isaiah. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. Yes. 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 Okay, thank you. Help me. Look at me, everybody. This scripture is a prophetic scripture. It both refers to the nation called Israel and refers to the church today. Because all over the world, once you receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you are already in the church of God. Yeah. So why is the prophecy? He says, arise, shine, for the light of God has come upon you, and that the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Can I hear someone say amen? Put two fingers towards me like this. Put two fingers like this. Somebody say light, glory. Shout one more time, light and glory. Arise, shine, for thy light has come. Light here refers to knowledge. When knowledge comes, the door is open for the manifestation of God's glory. What you know gives you power to receive. What you know gives you power to perform. What you know positions you to receive more from God. And I announce to somebody here tonight, you are going to receive. Many of you shall receive double portion of God's anointing, double portion of his glory, double portion of his power.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Light is knowledge. Light is a door opener. Light empowers you to see the manifestation of God's glory. Jesus was born. Jesus was an embodiment of God's glory. But I'm talking about manifestation now. Manifestation means to manifest. To manifest means to show forth. So when we have the glory of God, then we should show forth. Every time you have the glory of God, there's an honor of God in your life. Every time you have the glory of God, there's the power of God in your life. Every time you have the glory of God, there's the dignity of God in your life. Every time you have the glory of God, there's the majesty of God in your life. I tell you the truth, the glory of God makes you God to the forces of this life.
Yeah, the chaplains, they understood me. But can I help you?
When you have the glory of God, when you have the glory of God, the glory of God in you makes you God over the forces of darkness on the surface of the earth. So hear me, sir. God stooped down, shaped the soil, molded a man, lifeless, no purpose, no useful, no design, no destiny. Then he stooped down. Why would God stoop down? The value he placed on that which is created. So he breathed into the nostril of the man. And the man rose up. The Bible says he became a living soul. And the moment he received the glory of God in his life, everything on the surface of the earth became subject to him. The glory of God shall restore you to your place, to your place of authority, to your place of dominion. Everything shall become subject to you. Sicknesses shall become subject to you. Diseases shall become subject to you. Premature death shall become subject to you. Poverty shall become subject to you. Oppressions shall become subject to you. Witches and wizards shall become subject to you. In the mighty name of Jesus.
And his authorization was given.
He says, subdue, dominate. So I came to provoke you. You've been keeping the glory of God for too long. Arise in the knowledge. Arise, because the knowledge has come. The light has come. Exercise your dominion. Exercise that glory. You carry exactly what Adam carried before he committed sin. What was subject to God was subject to him. What bowed to God bowed to him. So from now, whatever bows to God will bow to you. Your destiny has been restored. Whatever surrenders to God, surrenders to you. I give you more of that light. When God created the heavens and earth, he owned the heavens and the earth. He ruled. Hear me, sir. You say you are going through the Bible college. Through theological college. Yeah, hear me. He ruled both on heavens and on earth. So he privileged a human being by the name of Adam. He created him. He said, because I create you after my image, I love you so much, I will divide and do what we call in economics, division of labor, in all management sciences,
division of labor. So the scripture confirms and says, the heaven of heavens is thine, O Lord, but the earth hast thou given to sons of men. I take it again. The earth you have given to sons of men. In other words, I rule in heaven. You rule here. I will only rule here through you. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Because you carry my glory. Can you laugh here in this hall? Can you laugh? Yeah, laugh louder. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. This is not about age. It's about identity. This is not about academics. It's about identity. What a professor binds, a laborer in the university will also bind. This is not about financial economic attainment. What a millionaire, a multi-millionaire, a multi-billionaire will bind. A poverty will also bind. It's about identity. You said, Pastor, you were talking about the light. Let me come back to the light. Where's the light now? The light I'm talking about, sir, chairman, I'm talking about knowing what you carry. You carry the glory. And somebody asked me, when did I carry the glory? The very day you received Jesus into your heart as your Lord and Savior, that was the day you carried the glory. Because the Bible said, Jesus in you is the hope of glory. So the very day you carried Jesus, you ceased to be an ordinary man. You became an extraordinary man. You ceased to be a natural woman. You became a supernatural woman. Hear me, sir. Hear me, ma. You became a combination of divinity and humanity. Whatever bow to God will bow to you. It's not your personal attainment. It's the gift of God. It's the choice of God. It's the free love of God. And by his love, he gave this to us freely. Freely you have received, freely make use of it. So, sir, a man, quite another man, lecturer at University of Georgia. One time, he was the head of the Department of Architecture. But I pastored him. So he had me teach things like this. Now, he had not yet married then. That's what I'm talking about. So he saw a lady. He's talking to a lady. Marriage committee, I've looked into it, they agreed. But by the time the medical test came, not HIV, but genotype, he was a carrier. The wife-to-be was also a carrier. That means if that man and his wife, you know better, we have a child, heaven kiss earth, the child must be sickle cell. So he remembered what he heard, that by receiving Jesus, the glory of God is back into him. He has been restored to what Adam was before he lost it. He said, what is subject to God is subject to me. Career is subject to me. He explained that enough to the wife-to-be. They held their hands and prayed. I wasn't there when they prayed. They told the marriage committee, there is something we believe. Give us a second chance to go and do test again. Please, after the prayer, they went and did test. No career. No career. They have three children. The first is reading Bachelor of Science Nursing in Canada. The second is about to enter university in Canada. The third is about to finish high school or in Canada, because they relocated and lived in Canada. None of them have sickle cell, not even threat of a career. I knew this. Two of my children, two. My second child, by the grace of God, has blessed me with four children that have grown people. My second child, when they did BCG, immunization is not treatment. Immunization is to introduce the bacteria of the disease they want to protect you from into your body so that your cells fight them and get ready to fight the disease. So when they did BCG, the first time we saw that the thing swore extraordinary. His blood couldn't carry the bacteria. After a while, he showed some certain signs. When we took him to hospital, they said he had tuberculosis. My wife came back from the hospital. She said, the result is that he has tuberculosis. I'm sorry, sometimes I get crazy. Sometimes, it's not always, but sometimes. Not always, but sometimes. I took the result. And I say, there can be no tuberculosis in this house. There can be no tuberculosis in this house. I was speaking from a life. Thy light has come. That glory has risen. I was speaking from a life. With what I carry, I cannot be the body of the temple of the Holy Ghost and be the temple of the killer bacteria again. Two of them cannot stay in the same temple. It is from that light. I was speaking from the light that I am the head of the house. I'm exercising authority of the head of the house. And my wife believes me. Please, wives, if you have God-fearing husbands, please believe them. If you have unbelieving husbands, you may doubt them. You may respect them, but you can doubt them. My wife believes me. So she waited. After 1 month, he took the same boy. The same hospital. The same test. His tuberculosis negative. That boy is a grown boy, strong and tall, no trace of tuberculosis. with the women in our church. They do Tuesday prayer meetings. So, he went and called her younger sister. She was married for 4 years and had had 7 miscarriages in 4 years. But I said, when you have the light and you know the glory you carry, controversies are settled. After now, you will settle controversies. So her senior sister wrote her. They are not members of our church. She explained something. And when she explained, she mentioned a dimension that made me angry. A demonic dimension. She said, every time I get pregnant, there's a dream I see. A snake trying to make love with me. She said, when that happens, then the pregnancy will go. She had had 7. So one time it lasted for 2 weeks, but it went. One time it lasted for 4 weeks, but it went. The moment she mentioned snake, that is settled my problem. So I know who snake is. The first appearance of Satan to man in Genesis chapter 3. He came in the body of a snake. So I knew that this is Satan. And if God said, subdue the earth, rule over the earth, Satan is one of the people in the earth. He's a tenant. He is not the owner of the house. He didn't have the gift of the house. Heaven of heavens is thine, for the earth hast thou given to sons of men, not sons of Satan. So when I knew that Satan, I told the woman, Satan is manipulating this pregnancy. When I explained that scripture, Genesis 3, she understood. What I'm begging for tonight, I'm begging for your understanding. Once you understand what we are preaching here, what the leadership of the church have brought to us, the glorious, once you understand it, I tell you the truth, your glory shall break forth. The woman understood. And so we prayed. After we prayed, I never saw her again. She wasn't a member of the church. If she got pregnant, the same symptoms I used to show me. It lasted for 3 months. He said, this one looks good though. It never dissolved. So happily she went to do tests. Other tests showed she was pregnant. The scanning said she was not pregnant. So I was sitting in the office one day. I saw somebody running, coming down, and knocking at the door. Is Pastor there? Is Pastor? I said, yes, I'm here. She came in sweating. The symptoms that I have gone for 3 months. Urine tests show pregnancy. Scanning say there's nothing. So I joked with her. That one was a joke. It was a joke. I said, the snake that left you went and entered the scanning machine so that they will not see the pregnancy. But I said, look at me. I'm not going to pray for you. I will rebuke that supper. I don't even know even the clinic. I don't know the that place. I don't even know it. But there's no distance in the spirit realm. In my office, held hand with her, rebuke that serpent, take off your manipulation over that machine. I told her, after 1 month, go to the same machine. After 1 month, she went to the same machine.
The machine says you are 4 months pregnant.
She gave birth to the first child. She gave birth to the second child. Then she came with her husband to give testimony. Last year, I met her in an occasion. I said, "Madam, you and your husband, since you have given birth to 2 children, you have run away from me." He said, "No, it's not 2 children. I said, "How many?" He said, 5. He said, "Until I told my husband it is too much." So we went and they tied this side and tied this side. She was sitting like this. They tied this side and tied this side. Hear me. Give understanding to this. There shall be a transformation in your life. Give understanding to this. You shall manifest the glory of God. We shall be that, thank you, the glorious church in Maiduguri, in a land that looks as if it's dry and there's no water. Even though you help me, upon your greeting me, say, "Welcome to the land, blessed land full of milk and honey." The purpose why God has manifested you here is so that when people are looking for God, when they see you, they should see God. When they hear you, they should hear God. When they visit you, they should see God. When they come in here, they should see God in manifestation. He said, "In the sanctuary, I will see the glory of the Most High God." A new order will be happening here. As people come into this assembly, sinners, they will be delivered here. They will walk out being born again. People coming here with sicknesses shall be healed. People coming here demon possessed. The deliverance theme in this church will increase in knowledge, in power. There shall be cases of deliverance. The men shall come in here. They shall be set free. For demons are subject to you. Demons are subject to you. Witches are subject to you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Last scripture. Let's stand up and hear this scripture. And I want us to pray. John chapter 3. Whosoever finds it, read. John chapter 3. Verses 30 and 31. Yeah, if you are going to see the glory of God, you get, hold on. If you are going to see the glory of God, this is the way, John saw the glory of God in a very tremendous way. What was his attitude? He's expressing his attitude. He must increase, but I must decrease. By illustration, we take our chaplain to be in the place of Jesus. So the more you allow Jesus to increase in your life, increase in your affairs, increase in your marriage, he is the ruler, he is the one dominating everything in your life. The more you do that, the more you see the glory of God. Verse 31. He that cometh from above is above how many? All. So all the issues that are confronting you, I introduce you to one who is above them all. Jesus, the Son of God, he that came from above is above all. You see, you are in an academic society. Many of you reading sciences. Well, something is not proven to you. You don't take things like until it is proven. That's why you do experiments. But can I say something to you? God has proved that Jesus is from above. And since he is from above, he's above all. I mentioned 3 proofs to you very quickly. At his baptism, he looked ordinary. As a matter of fact, it is sinners
who had to go for baptism. He wasn't a sinner by committer. He was a sinner by substitution. You all theological people will understand all of that. I take it again. He wasn't a sinner by committer. He was a sinner by substitution, by replacement. So as a sinner, look at even his birth. Can you imagine the Savior, King of Kings, is born and there is no even a crib in which to lay him. They lay him in a place where animals eat. Everything about him was so ordinary. He grew in a carpenter's shop. In church, he wasn't a deacon, he wasn't an elder. He was a reader. Very ordinary. So in that same ordinary manner, he went for the baptism. And the Savior who came to save us was not baptized to fulfill God's righteousness. But the Bible says in Matthew chapter 3 verse 16, he came up out of the water and the heavens opened. And the voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Proof number one that Jesus came from above. Proof number two. He said, and some weeks later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, and they went to the mount that theologians call Mount of Transfiguration. On that mountain, Moses came down, Elijah came down. I wouldn't know why they came, but I think this is it. Moses represented the law, Elijah represented the prophet, and since he's the fulfillment of the law and the prophet, the law, Moses, the prophet, Elijah, handed over to him in a very glorious arrangement. Peter woke out of sleep without thinking, without consultation. We make three tabernacles. God wanted to shout Peter and shout whosoever who said things anyhow. Shouted from heaven again. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And then he added, hear ye him. Authorization. You don't know the meaning. Hear ye him, you the Jews. Hear ye him, you the Gentiles. Hear ye him, you the kings, you the lawyers. Hear ye him, you the scientists. One of the greatest signs I went to experience myself. Since I was in Houston, I said, please let me take me to NASA Center. I went to NASA. I was so shocked. Shocked. They took me through, and we sat in the hall, and they had given us a lecture. They said, that computer is showing us. He said, these people are so and so far, so distance in the air over Russia. This satellite showing by this one is over Mali. Then France had come, and they were fighting those rebels in Mali, and America is keeping every detail by sending one satellite to hang over there. Scientists, hear ye him. Demons should hear him. Sickness in your body should hear him. Poverty in your pocket should hear him. Crisis in your family should hear him. Authority. Can I hear someone say amen?